In this module, we discuss the deadly virtue of selflessness. A fundamental ethical question involves asking, who is the primary beneficiary of one's morality, self or others? This gospel primacy issue lies at the heart of the restored gospel and plan of salvation. It should not surprise us that those philosophers and theologians who incorrectly give the gospel primacy to love over life also incorrectly give the gospel primacy to others over self. Imagine three friends go camping. One boy brings along a box of cookies. As he is eating around the campfire, the other boy's mouths start watering and they ask for one. Imagine he tells them all, "No way," and eats the entire box of cookies himself. We call this selfishness. He has undue regard for himself at the expense of others. The victor is himself, and the victims are everyone else around him. Now imagine that he refuses to eat a single cookie himself. He gives the entire box to others to eat, and he takes none for himself. We call this selflessness. He has undue regard for everyone else at the expense of himself. He is the victim, and everyone else are the victors. Again, this is a zero-sum game with a winner and loser. Now imagine he shares the cookies with his friends. Both he and his friends enjoy eating the box of cookies together, and their friendship grows from the shared experience. We call this unselfishness. He has due regard for himself and others. There is no victor nor victim. We call this a positive sum game because no one wins at someone else's expense. There is a tendency sometimes for people to mix up the word unselfish with selfless as being the same thing. Selfful describes a person that is concerned about bettering oneself without disregarding others. Selfful means you can have a full life. You can have your cookies and friends too. Consider our gospel target model. The target is unselfishness. What would be undershooting? This would be selfishness, all taking and no giving. What would be the overshooting? This would be selflessness, all giving and no taking. The gospel target would be selfful, give and take where everyone benefits. Christ gives the atonement and takes our covenants to obey the conditions for it. Value ethics give and take is like a plant. People tend to focus only on the giving part, the flower, and neglect to give credit to the taking part, the roots. Which has primacy, the giving part of the flower, or the taking part, the root? Without roots, do you have a flower? For all plant life, the roots have primacy. The giving is always rooted in first taking. Ground cover makes the give and take of the plant more aesthetically pleasing. The same is true of mankind. All giving a person can possibly do, such as love, friendship, and so on, must first do some level of taking. Without first taking, what do you have to give? The universal standard for all of mankind's give and take is eternal life. Mankind's life is also rooted in taking. In this give and take, within a marriage, within a family, within a business partnership, and so on, the ground cover are the common courtesies, such as please, thank you, contracts, covenants, and so on. These common courtesies make the give and take less grinding. With eternal life in mind, we give and take, obeying law as we grow from grace to grace. Initially, it is all take until we become strong enough to then be able to give. In the law of consecration, what does the Lord take from us? Everything. What does He give us in return? Everything, even more than He took. In Doctrine and Covenants 84:38 it says, "And he that receiveth my Father receiveth my Father's kingdom. Therefore, all that my Father hath shall be given unto him." A few examples of this pattern are declaring truth. First, we must gain an understanding of the truth before we can declare the truth. Christ revealed to Hiram Smith, "Seek not to declare my word, but first seek to gain my word." How about sharing testimony? First, we must obtain a testimony for ourselves before we can share it with others. How about the ordinances of the temple? First, we must obtain all ordinances for ourselves before we can do them in holy temples for others. Consider self-reliance. Only when we are self-reliant can we emulate the Savior in serving and blessing others. Warning: if you unconditionally love the primary song, "Give Said the Little Stream," you won't be able to unsee what you are about to see, and you might want to fast forward this video a bit. Elder Maxwell said, "In my primary days, we sang, 'Give Said the Little Stream.' Certainly sweet and motivating, but not exactly theologically drenched. Today's children, as you know, seeing the more spiritually focused, I'm trying to be like Jesus. Quotes like this from general authorities are their gentle way of rebuking the doctrine being taught. As written, Give Said the Little Stream is others over self or duty ethics. As written, and as Elder Maxwell points out, Give Said the Little Stream is not exactly drenched in theological doctrine. From an overshooting selflessness perspective, it is focused only on the giving when it says, Give said the little stream, give, oh, give, give, oh, give, singing, singing all the day, give away, oh, give away. What happens to a selfless stream? How long can the stream keep up the giving all the day? It is perhaps a beautiful sentiment, but impossible to live, and death for the stream, flower, or person that really tries to live it. Without the stream or person cheating to avoid its own death when its life resources run out, it might as well be singing Eternalism's alternate ending, which says, Give said the dry stream bed, give oh give, till you're dead. How would the song be written from a selfish, undershooting perspective? Take, said the little stream, take oh take, singing, singing all the day, take away, oh take away. What happens to a selfish stream? All take is an unsustainable cancer, growing until it has nothing or no one left to take from. It then dies ugly and obnoxious. Like the Dead Sea, it turns corrupt. How would the song be written from an unselfish value ethics perspective? Take and give, said the little stream, take and give, oh take and give, singing, singing all the day, take and give all day. What happens to an unselfish or selfful stream? It takes and gives, making everything grow and progress, beautiful, sustainable, and long-lived. Only through take and give can a stream, flower, or person live a sustainable, beautiful, long-lived life. In duty ethics, the self must be entirely done away. C.S. Lewis said, The moment you have a self at all, there is a possibility of putting yourself first. Wanting to be God in the center, wanting to be God in fact. And out of that hopeless attempt has come the long, terrible story of man trying to find something other than God which will make him happy. Do we want to become gods? Is it hopeless? Is it a terrible story? The First Presidency said, Man is a child of God, formed in the divine image and endowed with divine attributes. And even as the infant son of an earthly father and mother is capable in due time of becoming a man, so the undeveloped offspring of celestial parentage is capable, by experience, through ages and eons of evolving into a god. From value ethics, the self is given primacy. Joseph Smith said, Every man lives for himself. President Brigham Young said, Every good that man performs is firstly for his own benefit and eternal welfare, if he continues in well-doing, and secondly, for the common good of others. First and foremost is to secure our own salvation and do right pertaining to ourselves, and then extend the hand of right to save others. He also said, When I labor in the kingdom of God, I labor for my own dear self. I have self continually before me. The object of my pursuit is to benefit my individual person, and this is the case with every person who ever was or ever will be exalted. Elder Jeffrey R. Holland said, The personal value, the sacred splendor of every one of you, is the very reason there is a plan for salvation and exaltation. Contrary to the parlance of the day, this is about you. No, don't turn and look at your neighbor. I am talking to you. In duty ethics, any desire for gain is immoral. Duty ethics is literally good for nothing. Anders Nygren said, Love towards God does not seek to gain anything. It must certainly not seek to gain anything other than God, but neither does it seek to gain even God himself or his love. The very thought of gaining anything, even of gaining God's love, is fundamentally alien to it. It is a free and, in that sense, spontaneous surrender of the heart to God. Value ethics takes an opposite approach. Value ethics is good for the whole pile. Doctrine and Covenants 84:38 says, And he that receiveth my Father receiveth my Father's kingdom. Therefore, all that my Father hath shall be given unto him. President Brigham Young said, For whose benefit are we laboring? For our own. All my preaching, laboring, and toils in this kingdom have been for myself, to get into the celestial kingdom of God. I have been laboring for that and nothing else. He also said, I used to tell the people, and I tell them the same now, I do not go in for a few millions, I go in for the whole pile, and I calculate to have it. How are you going to get it? By serving God with all my heart and being a saint indeed. And when the earth and its fullness are given into the hands of the saints, I shall go in for my share, the whole pile. I used to say why Brother Joseph is the greatest speculator I have ever heard of in modern times. He is going to have the whole earth. Consider the following scriptures taken from both a duty ethics and a value ethics perspective. 1 Corinthians 13:4-5 from a duty ethics perspective would say, Charity seeketh not her own, absolutely, in any way whatsoever. From a value ethics perspective, it would read, Charity seeketh not her own, if it be at the unjust expense of others. 1 Corinthians 10:24 would say, Let no man seek his own, ever, but every man another's wealth, always. From a value ethics perspective, it would read, Let no man seek his own, at the unjust expense of others, but every man another's wealth, as part of his own selfful life. Philippians 2:3-4 from a duty ethics perspective would read, But in lowliness of mind, let each esteem other better than themselves, unconditionally. Look not every man on his own things, ever, but every man on the things of others. From a value ethics perspective, it would read, But in lowliness of mind, let each esteem other better than themselves, selffully. Look not every man exclusively on his own things, but every man also on the things of others. Looking how any scripture or statement can be interpreted differently depending on the perspective of the reader, it is a fundamental error to take any single statement or scripture, like Charity seeketh not her own, and run with it while selectively ignoring the overall context. Seekers of truth pay attention to all the available evidence. So can you think of any scriptures supporting the value ethics perspective of self over others? Altruism is the belief in the selfless benefit for others at your own expense. Consider the following selfful scriptures that the altruists conveniently ignore. Was the Apostle Paul an altruist? In Hebrews 11:6, he said, For he that cometh to God must believe that he is, and that he is a rewarder of them that diligently seek him. In 2 Timothy 4:7-8, he said, I have fought a good fight. I have finished my course. I have kept the faith. Henceforth, there is laid up for me a crown of righteousness, which the Lord, the righteous judge, shall give me at that day, and not to me only, but unto all them also that love his appearing. Was the Apostle John an altruist? In 2 John 1:8, he said, Look to yourselves, that we lose not those things which we have wrought, but that we receive a full reward. Was the Book of Mormon prophet Alma an altruist? In Alma 41:14, he said, Therefore, my son, see that you are merciful unto your brethren, deal justly, judge righteously, and do good continually. And if ye do all these things, then shall ye receive your reward. Was the Book of Mormon prophet King Benjamin an altruist? In Mosiah 4:27, he said, And again it is expedient that ye should be diligent, that thereby ye might win the prize. Therefore, all things must be done in order. In Mosiah 1:7, he said, And now, my sons, I would that ye should remember to search them diligently, that ye may profit thereby. And I would that ye should keep the commandments of God, that ye may prosper in the land, according to the promises which the Lord made unto our fathers. Was the patriarch Abraham an altruist? In Abraham 1:1-2, he said, I, Abraham, finding there was greater happiness and peace and rest for me, I sought for the blessings of the fathers. Were Joseph Smith and Hiram Smith altruists? In Doctrine and Covenants 135:6, it said, They lived for glory, they died for glory, and glory is their eternal reward. Clearly, the scriptural evidence is overwhelming that these and other prophets were out to receive a personal reward and prosper personally. How about Christ himself? Was Christ himself an altruist? Let's consider Christ's own words in his dialogue with Peter. In Matthew 19:27-29, it says, Then answered Peter and said unto him, Behold, we have forsaken all, and followed thee. What shall we have therefore? And Jesus said unto them, Verily I say unto you, every one that hath forsaken houses, or brethren, or sisters, or father, or mother, or wife, or children, or lands, for my name's sake, shall receive 100-fold, and shall inherit everlasting life. Now, if Christ's gospel were duty ethics, others over self, wouldn't this have been an excellent time to rebuke Peter by saying something like, Shame on you, Peter. What a selfish question. You should be altruistic and forget about yourself or any reward for your own actions and focus solely on others. It's immoral to expect anything from this, Peter. You should just do it because it's your duty. But that's not what Christ said. In fact, Christ preached the opposite. In Doctrine and Covenants 58:28, Christ said, "And inasmuch as men do good, they shall in no wise lose their reward." In Doctrine and Covenants 59:23, Christ said, "But learn that he who doeth the works of righteousness shall receive his reward, even peace in this world and eternal life in the world to come." A crown of glory is a good metaphor describing the selfful life of value ethics. A crown of thorns is a good metaphor describing the destructive selflessness of duty ethics. President Brigham Young described how there is no such thing as sacrificing for God. It is all sacrifice for ourselves. He said, "It is for my own benefit, it is for your benefit, it is for my own wealth and happiness, and for your wealth and happiness, that we pay tithing and render obedience to any requirement of heaven. I would not give the ashes of a rye straw for the man who feels that he is making sacrifices for God. We are doing this for our own happiness, welfare, and exaltation, and for nobody else's. So if we are doing everything for our own happiness, why bother to help others at all?" God's help in your life can greatly benefit your life. Doing good things to other of God's children brings His blessings to you. Christ described this in Matthew 25:40 when He said, "And the king shall answer and say unto them, Verily I say unto you, inasmuch as ye have done it unto one of the least of these my brethren, ye have done it unto me." We all live in a society, a neighborhood, a community, a state, a country, and so on. Others are part of our life. Life would be lonely and much less meaningful to us without others to share our life with. So the real question is, what kind of society would you want to live in? Christ also answered this question in Matthew 7:12 when He said, "Therefore, all things whatsoever ye would that men should do to you, do ye even so to them." We all should want to live in a society where people take care of each other. It's not wise to face reality all by yourself. Thank you for watching this video. Please subscribe to the Christian Eternalism YouTube channel and visit www.christianeternalism.org.